Miss Kate Mulgrew.
Examination of my gender until I finally marched into
producer's office and I said, you know, Rick Berman, you've got to stop this. If those people are examining my bosoms with the same intensity as you all are, it gives Star Trek a very bad name to be. Right? Why don't you just let them learn to trust me, care about me, follow me? Let me become the captain I want to be. Let me endow Janeway with Mulgrew, Mulgrew with Janeway, and then we'll make a marriage that will last. Otherwise, you're looking at a divorce here. Leave me alone. I'm a girl. I know how to boss these big boys around. I'm the oldest of eight in an Irish family. Lending a whole community to Red Alerts. And slowly but surely, they did. They let him go. And at that point, the alchemy did happen between Janeway and Mulgrew. And I owned her. And I had then six following ensuing seasons of great discovery, often joy, but mostly a kind of deep and mysterious pride. Patrick Stewart met me the first week I was on the set, and he said, he came in to have a cup of coffee. He was sort of leaning against the crafts of his chair, watching the program. He has no problem with his hairdo. Watching me. And I came over, they gave me a 2 second break. And I came over and I said, tell me how to get through this 7 years. How did you do it? He said, I'm going to tell you this once over. I can assure you that if you come in here and invest with 100% of your being, at the end of 7 years, you should be proudest of this than of all the body of your work put together. I said, thank you, Captain. And he was right. And when we meet now, we have drinks, which we do in airports. Secretly. I have to take him away from all of those beauties who are always pursuing him in the airport. So I knock him down and say, Sir Patrick, come and have a drink with me. And we always say it's the best part of life. And you know he's a great Shakespearean actor. But when you do 7 years in this franchise, you've earned your stripes, you know? And especially as a woman, I was raising 2 small children. You know, these were 15, 16, 18 hour days for the first 2 seasons. That's a long, long week. So I was inordinately proud. And of course it is defining. I knew that. I knew that going in. And I know what my hope is gonna be like. Kate Mulgrew, Captain Janeway, finally dies at 125. I know it will be Captain Janeway, but my rejoinder to that is, and? Could it possibly be better than that? Right? So it's been marvelous, absolutely marvelous. I'm thrilled. This usually goes very quickly, so I want to take questions. Do any of you have any questions? Yes, stand now. Stand up. Went for very big. Who has a question? Do you have another mic? All right. I'll vamp while you're getting it. So it's all been terrific. I come up here and I do Warehouse 13. I'm going to do some more. In the spring, I'm doing a play in New York called Somewhere Fun by the exceedingly talented Jenny Schwartz, directed by Anne Kaufman. So for those of you who are avid theatergoers, please come. In New York in the spring. And my life is very good. I have 3 children, allegedly. And they're now, you know, getting on. And I remind them of that. And they give me great joy. I live in New York City. My life is interesting. I have the same group of intimate friends I've had since I was 23. I love to read. I love to have dinner parties. I love to cook, I love to walk, I love to write. So I am writing a book about my experiences, not only as Captain Janeway, but as Kate Mulgrew, as Captain Janeway. Who has a question for me? Yes. You have a very interesting question. Where's the microphone for you? There, go on there, darling.
I
What was my favorite episode? Is that what you're asking?
Yes.
Who was my favorite villain?
Villain.
Well, you know the answer to that. Now, that's a rhetorical question. You know very well that she has funny things sticking out of her head. A skin-tight costume, but she looks great. She's the Borg Queen, and I had to take her down, dude. Scared me.
Oh.
Organ snatchers.
Yeah.
I used to take that stuff home with me. I used to say to my children, eat it, or I'm sending the Medeans. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Good man. Right. Who else? Come on, put it out here more so people can come and ask questions and not feel that they can't. That was articulated poorly, don't you know that? Why don't I mean what?
There's many more female
I'm going to tell you, the answer to this is not going to resonate, but I'm going to be honest because I'm at an age where I can. Okay? It is physically and constitutionally so hard. That's why men have been captains. You stand on your feet for 18 hours, right? The technobabble I had to learn and retain for those 18 hours and do it again and again and again. Our makeup. Our biological makeup does not lend itself to standing all of that time, right? Let alone marching, shaking, falling, phasering, whatever I was doing. So the physical constitution is first. The mental retention, right, is second. Very hard, because it's not a jolly place. You come into work on that set, and you have to work. I mean, I got up at 4 o'clock in the morning. I drove myself. Nobody picked me up. I drove an hour to Paramount. I was in the chair at 5. I was on the set at 5:30, quarter to 6. And I was home at 10 at night. That's a long day. And you can't once flag, because if you do, everybody else will. The captain sets the tone. And it's bad enough I was surrounded by those big boys, you know. And they were all in bathrobes. The camera was on me, they were in robes, half naked, right? Spitballing each other. So that was difficult. I also knew I was being watched. As you know, the part originally went to the great French-Canadian actress, Sylvia Bougeau. Thank you. Especially if that came from a Canadian. And especially if that came from a French Canadian. Anyway, she said after one day, I don't know what you're doing here. This is insane. How can you possibly work 18 hours? I have a son, I have to eat, I have to drink the wine, I have to say. And she had her own way of delivering engage, which was, which is a little tough in the Delta Quadrant, you know what I mean? So she very courageously left after one day. They came back right away after me and then two other women, I think, and I think some men, a handful of men. Because they were thinking to themselves, a woman is not going to take this job, not going to be able to last. She lasted one day and had to get home, right? So I accepted it. But I say to you without exaggeration, for the first full season, 30 men in suits walked into that soundstage every day, stood in front of me with their arms crossed, and just watched. Day in and day out. Not a barrel of laughs. Right? So it was overcoming all of that stuff, not jailing yourself. Although the technobabble was very tough, right? I didn't have a clue. What am I talking about? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? And then somebody said, get the Okuda Bible, read Richard Feynman, and study Einstein. And do it all overnight and you'll be fine. And I did it all within the year, and I was fine. Because I understand that it's all rooted in truth. This is why I get so mad when people disdain Star Trek. What they're disdaining is their own ignorance. Do you know what I'm saying? Not disdaining, what they're pointing out is their own ignorance. Because it's all grounded in science. That's the truth of it. It's such a great thing and so wildly successful. These are people who understood what Einstein said when he said, I hope that this calculation is correct, but I'm saying, I hope. It's a leap of the scientific imagination. That's the essence of Star Trek and its beauty. Thank you for your question. Does that answer your question? I did wax on, didn't I? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Lovely lady. Come on up here. How are you, sir? Hi, George.
I have some really big fans in the third row there.
Stand up, big fans in the third row.
Every night they watch Voyager.
Oh, guys, you're great. You're so great. So it's here. It airs here every night. On what channel? On what?
Space.
Oh, on space. Well, that makes sense, doesn't it? Okay. What's your question? Smartest of the smart. I just took the speech and under the table I threw freshman. And I looked at them and I said, you know very well there is nothing I can say to you. It is you who have given this to me. But in concert, what we do is take wing. Because everybody knows that we're a pop culture. If it's on television, it can be possible. So afterwards, a group of girls who had graduated from MIT came up to me, beautiful girls, smart. Their faces radiant with intelligence. I mean, the kind of face, if I were a guy. I'm a girl. And they looked at me and they said, do you know something, Miss Mulgrew? My father, who was an astrophysicist, said to me, honey, it's great that you're gonna study, but I think you should think about research. There's no place for women in the field. And then Star Trek Voyager came on. My father and I watched it. She said, and now, Miss Mulgrew, I'm going to NASA. Thank you very much. So when you have even one experience like that as an actress, extraordinary. So, it was great. Did I answer your question?
Yes,
you did. I got up very early, went to bed very late. How are you? I'm not sure I approve of your colors.
Controversial issues in the movie, like suicide, racism, discrimination. I was wondering if there were any controversial issues you would have liked to address that were not dealt with in the series.
Yes, homosexuality. Was not touched. And I felt strongly that it should be. Because race was, creed was, gender. But I think that we needed to have an absolutely outspoken homosexual in a position of command. And I fought for that, and I think that they just weren't ready, but they're ready now. It's coming around the corner. Just as it took them so long to put a lady in the seat. Do you know what I mean? It takes them a long time to catch the wave, but they are. So that, and I think I would have liked a further and deeper examination of Janeway's particular kind of loneliness. It's one thing to be a Picard or a Kirk in space, if you get my drift. So that they all came to me and they said, you think you should have an affair with Chakotay? I said, the first officer, the guy in the seat next to me, what the hell is gonna happen to the ship? Who's gonna run this thing, right? Talk about red alert. I said, absolutely not. Because I was sure, convinced that you, a young man, and you, all men would look at me as a woman of childbearing years having an affair with her first officer and say, she's a lousy leader. So I said, I'm not gonna do this. I'm not gonna do it. And there was a lot of, you know, I got some bad feedback on that one, but I said, we'll have a hologram and I will design. A 5'3" Irishman. Anyway, does that answer your question? Or do you have another one? Okay, you're very nice, very, very good looking. Yes. Now, here's an example, ladies and gentlemen, of not only strange colors, but he's wearing camping shorts and neon sneakers. What's your question? What's your compliment? You have 62. So you realize that you're responsible for 165 lives. The Delta Quadrant is not charted. The likelihood of getting back in 75,000 light years is very slim. How do we survive? It's overwhelming. So the first thing I said to myself was, how do I keep the sense that I am overwhelmed in check and allow my humanity to come through, because it's the only thing that's going to allow us to survive. So I built on personal relationships. And that was my personal secret as Janeway. And I would suggest you do the same. However, as a scientist, I think that you can do whatever you want, don't you? Is this what you wear to class? You were the full Star Trek. Are you a good teacher? Do you have a, are you brilliant in your own opinion?
I'm just as smart as somebody
like that. No, you're not. I'll bet you're very, very good. Anyway, I hope that helps you.
It does.
Thank you. Thank you. Hi. How are you? Sweetie, tip that down so I can hear your voice. And forgive me for calling you, sweetie, but I can do that too, if I can do that. What's your question? And come forward to me.